we see concerning pleasures. There are pleasures of the soul and pleasures of the body. The pleasures of the soul are those which are the exclusive possessions of the soul, such as the pleasures of learning and contemplation. The pleasures of the body, however, are those which are enjoyed by soul and body in fellowship, and hence are called bodily pleasures. And such are the pleasures of food and intercourse and the alike. But one could not find any class of pleasures belonging solely to the body. Again, some pleasures are true, others false, and the exclusively intellectual pleasures consist in knowledge and contemplation, while the pleasures of the body depend upon sensation. Furthermore, of bodily pleasures, some are both natural and necessary, in the absence of which life is impossible. For example, the pleasures of food, which replenishes waste, and the pleasures of necessity, which are clothes. Others are natural but not necessary, as the pleasures of natural and lawful intercourse. For though the function that these perform is to secure the performance of the race as a whole, it is still possible to live a virgin life apart from them. That means you can choose to abstain from sexual intercourse. Okay, this is one other pleasure that you can force. But the pleasure that deals with things like food and clothing, those pleasures, even though they are possible in this life, they are both natural, they are both also necessary. You have to put on clothes. You can't be walking around in society naked. And you have to eat food as well in order for your body to continue to carry out its function on the earth. But pleasures of sex, you can choose to abstain from it and be a virgin all your life, which Christ talks about as celibacy as well. So you can choose to do that. And Apostle Paul also highlights on that as well. And Moses also speaks about that as well. Others, however, are neither natural nor necessary, such as drunkenness, lust, and surfeiting to excesses. For these contribute neither to the maintenance of our own lives nor to the succession of the race, but on the contrary, are rather even a hindrance. He, therefore, that will live a life acceptable to God must follow after those pleasures which are both natural and necessary, and must give a secondary place to those which are natural but not necessary. That means things like food, wearing of clothes, those pleasures are natural and necessary. Those are the first pleasures. Then things like sex are secondary pleasures, okay? And enjoying them only in fitting seasons and manner and measures, while the others must be altogether renounced. And those he referred to as being renounced are things like drunkenness, lust, and surfeiting to excess. Okay? Those then are to be considered moral pleasure, which are not bound up with pain and bring no cause for repentance and result in no other harm, and keep within the bounds of moderation, and do not draw us far away from serious occupation, nor make slaves of us. So things like drunkenness and lust can make you slave, okay? But things like wearing of clothes and eating food, those are not things that should enslave you, okay? Those are things that should just be natural, that you should participate in, okay? Put on clothes, good clothes, just to go out. You don't need to go after those high earning clothes. If you can afford them, why not? You go after them and you purchase them for yourself and you wear them, things like jewelries and all those other things that are in the world that people chase after. Those are secondary things. The main important thing, first of all, is that you wear a clothes and then you are able to eat. All right? So other things follows as well. So we go on further then. And energy. Passion is a word with various meanings. It is used in regard to the body and refers to diseases and wounds. And again, It is used in reference to the soul and means desire and anger. But to speak broadly and generally, passion is an animal affection which is succeeded by pleasure and pain. For pain succeeds passion, but is not the same thing as passion. For passion is an affection of things without sense, but not so pain. Pain then is not passion, but the sensation of passion, and it must be considerable, that is to say, it must be great enough to come within the scope of sense. Again, the definition of passions of the soul is this: passion is a sensible activity of the appetitive faculty, depending on the presentation to the mind of something good or bad. Or, in other words, passion is an irrational activity of the soul, resulting from the notion of something good or bad. For the notion of something good results in desire, and the notion of something bad results in anger. But passion considered as a class, that is, passion in general, is defined as a movement in one thing caused by another. Energy, on the other hand, is a drastic movement, and by drastic is meant that which is moved of itself. Thus, anger is the energy manifested by the part of the soul where anger resides, whereas passion involves the two divisions of the soul, and in addition to the whole body when it is forcibly impelled to action by anger. For there has been caused movement in one thing caused by another, and this is called passion. But in another sense, energy is spoken of as passion, for energy is a movement in harmony with nature, whereas passion is a movement at variance with nature. Accordingly, then, to this view, energy may be spoken of as passion when it does not act in accordance with nature, whether its movement is due to itself or to some other thing. Thus, in connection with the heart, its natural pulsation is energy, whereas its palpitation, which is an excessive and unnatural movement, is passion and not energy. But it is not every activity of the passionate part of the soul that is called passion, but only the more violent ones, and such are capable of causing sensation. But the minor and unperceived movement are certainly not passions. For to constitute passion, there is necessary a considerable degree of force. And thus, it is on this account that we add to the definition of passion that it is a sensible activity. For the lesser activities escape the notice of the senses and do not cause passion. Observe also that our soul possesses twofold faculties, those of knowledge and those of life. The faculties of knowledge are mind, thought, notion, presentation, and sensation. And the vital or appetitive faculties are will and choice. Now, to make what has been said clearer, let us consider these things more closely. First, let us take the faculties of knowledge. Presentation and sensation, then, we go on further, and we see consigning energy. All the faculties we have already discussed, both those of knowledge and those of life, both the natural and artificial, are, it is to be noted, called energy. For energy is the natural force and activity of each essence. Or again, natural energy is the activity innate in every essence. And so, clearly, things that have the same essence have also the same energy, and things that have different natures have also different energies. For no essence can be devoid of natural energy. Natural energy, again, is the force in each essence by which its nature is made manifest. And again, natural energy is the primer, eternally moving force of the intelligent soul, that is, the eternally moving world of the soul, which ever springs naturally from it. And yet again, natural energy is the force and activity of each essence, which only that which is not lacks. But actions are also called energies. For instance, speaking, eating, drinking, and such like. The natural affections also are often called energies. For instance, hunger, taste, and so forth. And yet again, the result of the force is also often called energy. Things are spoken of in a twofold way, as being potential and actual. For we say that a child at the breast is a potential scholar, for he is so equipped that, if taught, he will become a scholar. Furthermore, we speak of a potential and actual scholar, meaning that the latter is reversed in letters, while the former has the power of interpreting letters, but does not put it into actual use. Again, when we speak of an actual scholar, we mean that he put his power into actual use. That is to say, that he really interprets writings. It is therefore to be observed that in the second sense, potentiality and actuality go together. For the scholar is in the one case potential and in the other actual. The primer and only true energy of nature is the voluntary or rational and independent life which constitutes our humanity. I know not how those who rob the Lord of this can say that he became man. Energy is drastic activity of nature, and by drastic is meant that which is moved of itself. Go on further.